Hi, this is Graham from Jenham's Astro. This video aims to see if you can take decent astrophotos of deep sky objects using a small scope like this, the Celestron C90. Now, if you watch my channel, you'll know that I'm a big fan of this scope. It's small, lightweight and well made, and it's fantastic for observing the moon and the planets. Now, people often ask me if they can use scopes like this for deep sky observing as well as for the planets and the moon. My usual answer is sometimes. Small macs are fine for viewing deep sky objects if they're small and bright, but large fuzzy targets like distant galaxies or emission nebulae either won't fit into its field of view or they're just too dim to see. Still, it got me thinking about whether I could get any decent photos of these brighter deep sky objects using this scope and a relatively low-tech mount. Okay, so this is the setup. We've got the C90. I've added a different finder. This is a red dot finder, replacing the stock finder, which is really too small. Alternatives to this might be something like a tail rad finder or a larger optical finder scope. So I've got a digital SLR. This is a Canon 700D, and we're going to capture the images from this using the free EOS utility software running on a laptop. The scope is on an equatorial mount with a motor in one axis, just in the right ascension axis. Now this is a rather nice fixed mount, but in terms of its size and its payload capacity, a cheaper EQ3 mount, the sort of thing you might have with a decent first telescope, is broadly speaking a similar kind of mount. And also there are alternatives now for tracker mounts that are capable of carrying lightweight imaging setups. But the idea really is that it's a relatively basic imaging setup. So what does that mean? Well, it means we're not going to use go-to, so we're going to be star hopping to the targets. We haven't got a guide scope attached, so simple use of a red dot finder. So we're not going to have a guide scope, we're not going to have a guide camera, and we're not going to use any guiding apps. So it's a pretty simple approach. Okay, a quick word on object selection. So I use the Astronomy Tools website, which includes a field of view calculator, so you can see if an object will fit into the frame that you have. So Astronomy Tools, what you do is you select that you're going to do imaging mode in this case, and then you can choose both the telescope and the camera that you're going to use. So for the telescope, in this case the Celestron C90 is already in the list of scopes. If your scope isn't in here, you can type it in as a custom scope by putting its focal length and aperture, and then also you select a camera. Again, common DSLRs like the 700D are in the list. Then you choose your deep sky object. So in this case, if we were to choose something like Messier 45, the Pleiades, then and we click to add to the field of view, we can see that really it doesn't fit. The rectangle is showing us the field of view we're going to get from the camera with this particular object. So, and just to prove it, here we go. Here's the first frame I took with the C90, and it pretty well matches that you get from the Astronomy Tools. So this sort of large object isn't going to fit. Well, probably no real surprise. If we choose something a little bit smaller, here's the dumbbell, then this looks a much better candidate. So it clearly fits inside the field of view. And in fact, if we zoom in so that we can get a closer view, this is the predicted size of the object in the frame. And then here you go. This is one uncropped frame from the C90 of Messier 27. And I'm pretty happy with that. If we zoom in a little bit, crop the image, then all we've really done here is improve the brightness and the contrast. It's a little bit grainy, but overall I'm quite happy with the quality of this. So clearly planetary nebulae like this one are good targets, especially if they're bright and relatively large. Here's a globular. Again, globulars are great targets for small macs, and Messier 13 has come up really well. Nice tight ball of stars, nice and bright image. Really good target for this sort of scope. Now something a little bit different. This is one half of the double cluster. So this just shows you the idea of an open cluster. I think probably this particular image, it needs a little bit more time to bring out the colours and some more of the fainter stars, but it gives you an idea of a large extended object. And then back to a planetary, Messier 57.
This is the uncropped frame, and what a fantastic object. This is one frame, 60 seconds. And if we look a little bit closer, we just crop the frame. Really happy with that. It's caught the central star of the nebula really well, and nice view of the color as well. So the C90, I think it's done really well. Just, you can obviously take multiple frames and stack, get a better result, but for the simple approach, I'm happy with that. And then I mentioned emission nebulae, Messier 42. Can't really take a bad picture of it, but here you go. This is a single frame for 60 seconds, and it shows you that it does fit into the field of view. Obviously, larger top objects like the California Nebula won't fit.
So how did this work out? Well, it proved that 90 millimeters is enough to take decent deep sky object images for brighter targets. There's no real surprise there, I suppose. My normal imaging scope has a smaller aperture, but that scope operates at F5 and costs close to £1,000, whereas this one is close to F14 and costs under 200. So definitely possible to get some good results. But before you run outside with your small Mac or your starter scope, please remember the downsides. Long exposure astrophotography will only work with accurate tracking, and that's really where the real effort of astrophotography comes in. Finding targets with a high magnification small field of view scope like this is also quite difficult if you don't have a go-to setup. It can be frustrating, certainly not impossible as we've seen, but it's not straightforward to go outside and get some good results without practice. Still, I think if you've got this kind of kit, it's worth giving it a try. And maybe if you're already an imager, why not challenge yourself to go back to that discarded old scope that you haven't used for a while and see if you can get some good frames. Okay, I hope this video has been useful. Please hit the red subscribe button if you'd like to see more astro videos on my channel. Thanks for watching.